What's up, everybody? Welcome to the show. This is the Lenny Reply. We don't play over here. I got an old soul, so I'm gonna let this rock and I'm gonna let the spinners roll. You dig? Let's go. Happy Monday, everybody. The only one for me. Meeting you was my destiny. You can be sure I will. Shout out to the spinners. When you need me, I'll be around. I can't even do the two-step in this chair, but it's all good. The only one for me. Heaven made you specially. Hold up, hold up, hold up. Hold up, hold up. What's up, everybody? Welcome to the show. I am your host, Lenny Reed, and this is episode... My bad. Hold up, I'm bucking. 172. And today we're going to talk about Alpha Centauri. Okay? But before I get to that, if you like this podcast, if you was a fan of this podcast... If you've been rocking with me for over four, well, close to 4 years now, November will be 4 years rocking. Give yourself a hand. It's not me. It's you. I appreciate you. So, also, if you would like to support this podcast, please slack one of those links in the description, okay? I got one more announcement also. I am adding another show per week, but this show will be a live show on YouTube. So YouTube channel is LR Pod Live. Please check that out. Please subscribe so you can get all the info of when my first live show going to be. So I wanted to do something to the factor of, you know, I put out a podcast here. It's a couple days later when I put it out. It's no real connection, right? It's just like, you know, I'll put it out. If you have any comments, you hold to yourself or you write me, whatever you do. People do different things. When they see me in the streets, they tell me. But this particular show on the YouTube channel, you will be able to text, right? And you can also come on the panel because I want to talk to people. I want to hear what people got to say. It'll be the same crazy topics. Actually, the topics probably be crazier. And it's going to go live, you know, one day during the weekend, whether it's Friday night, Saturday, that's it. It ain't going to be Sunday. And so get your drink, smoke, whatever you do, just tune in to LR Pod Live. It's going to be dope. I'm going to have guests on. It's going to be live. So go to LR Pod Live on YouTube. And, you know, subscribe so you can get all the information. And I'll probably be going live first show. The show will actually be on the list, so it'll be an actual number. So this is 172, right? So if I did a live show today, this weekend sometime, it'll be 173. So I'm just adding another show, but this other show is going to be live. Okay. All right. Let's get to the scene here. I got some notes because I wanted to come correct today. I wanted to basically talk about the reason I started this podcast, right? I started this podcast because space, right? I started this podcast, that light is getting on my goddamn nerves. But I started this podcast because of space and all the other shit that goes on in the world. And maybe it's people out there that think like me, that want a place to go and, I don't know, listen to some of the bullshit that they think going on. So that's why I started this podcast. Okay? So it's basically about humans in the future leaving Earth. And it's going to be a time where it's going to happen, regardless of how we look at it, regardless of... And, you know, some people might say, I'm not going to be here. I don't care. Yeah, but your legacy your family, some extension of your family will be here around that time, right? Because you can probably trace people all the way back to ancient Egypt, you know, or, you know, the kings of England or Ireland. You can trace people back all the way to those times, and it was thousands of years ago, right? So think about this. In less than probably 500, a couple hundred years, there is a place that we can actually go. So I'm going to break this place down. If you don't know this place, y'all probably need to check it out and like Google it and see, you know, if you can locate, find some more information. Probably try to get a YouTube channel going. Then they'll tell you basically all about that. So when you look at the situation now, planet Earth, it's sort of like the house that you grew up in that you don't respect. You probably respect the house that you move into that probably got everything you want. But the house you grew up in, you don't care. You don't care about if the sink leaking. You don't care if it need a nice coat of paint. You don't give a fuck about that, do you? No, you don't. So that's how people is treating Earth. Now, when it comes to the whole climate change situation, I don't know. I'm sort of like that the Earth probably goes through its seasons. You know, just like it got seasons now, it probably goes through hot periods, cold periods, ice age, you know, all of that stuff. So I'm not really on the fence, and I'm not really off the fence when it comes to climate change. So I would like to do more info, but I think Al Gore messed it up for me. But so this beautiful marble ball that has, you know, mainly blue seas, right? And brown land, right? This place of Moses, if you believe in that. Genghis Khan killing all these people. It's history, no matter how you look at it, no matter how you spin it. King Tut, Michael Jackson. Thriller. Do y'all remember Thriller? Come on, man. Do y'all remember Thriller? Anyway, this place is littered with skeletons from the distant past, right? But all of these memories that we see before us, all of these memories that we have on this planet will one day cease to exist. So if you say, why do I still hear that music? So if you say one thing like this, if you say life, right? If you say life itself is precious, life is beautiful. There's only one place that life is right now, and that's on planet Earth. And eventually, our day will come. The human race. Our day is coming, and it's going to be a sad day because in the distant future, our beautiful mother, this little thing that gives us light like it is outside right now, the beautiful thing that gives us heat, that powers, you know, the oceans, so the oceans can have its own little flow. It powers solar panels so people can have electric or whatever going on in the situation. Also, it's deadly. It shoots out rays, and we just have a perfect planet to protect us, you know, from the deadly rays that we get from the sun. But in the future, far future, I will say far, far, far future, our sun will expand. It will expand to the point that it will engulf our planet. But way before that happened, as the sun runs out of, hydrogen. As the sun runs out of hydrogen, it expands. So it will get hot way before, it'll probably be unbearable way before the sun gets to Earth itself. But the crazy thing is, once it gets to this Earth, it will basically boil and just crumble this planet up. So that's everybody that I just said. Because by that time, me and whoever's watching this, will be somewhere in the soil of this earth, right? We'll be somewhere down there. I don't care if they didn't paved over it 1,000 times. If you can find a dinosaur bone that's been in the ground for 250 million years, you will find us in that factor of some way, somehow. But all of that will come to an end. But this particular podcast is about solutions. This particular episode is about solutions. And it was always a planet that had me sort of like, I always wanted to know what was the closest star system that was, you know, a distance that sound close, but that shit is far as hell. And that star system is Alpha Centauri. Now, Alpha Centauri is a binary star system, meaning that just one star goes around another star like this, right? Now, it's possible that Alpha Centauri have planets, but I don't think they know that right now. Or if they do know, I don't know. But there is another star that's connected to that system. And as these planets spin, you know, I guess side to side, this particular star is somehow locked in their orbit. Sorry. So you have Alpha Centauri A and B, that's the stars. And then you have Proxima Centauri. And this is not like the other stars. Proxima Centauri is a red dwarf. So a red dwarf is about, let me say, I guess it should be probably 14% of the sun today that we have, that you see, that you feel every day. It's only 14% the size. So if it's only 14% of the size, you know the energy output is way less than the sun itself. So you know that this particular star system is very important to the human race because it's only 4.2 light years away, right? So when you say, what is a light year? A light year is the distance that light travels in a year. Now, light is very fast. I think that's the fastest thing we have in space that we know of right now. That's the fastest realm of travel. But let's get back to the lifespan of our planet, or the lifespan of our sun. Our sun lifespan is about 10 billion years. We already at 4 or 5 billion for the sun. So we're looking at another probably 5 billion years until the sun basically goes out. And I don't know if the sun will turn into a red dwarf. I don't know. I got to look that up. But the difference between our sun and Proxima Centauri is that Proxima Centauri has 4 trillion years to go, opposed to our sun only has 5 billion years to go. Now, can you imagine what people would look like 5 billion years from now? Do you think there would still be flesh and blood? Do you think there would still be love? Do you think there would still be war? Or is this what we have right now is the last of a beating heart, right? Is this the last of blood flowing through your body? You getting butterflies when you're in love. You know, you get angry. You want to beat the hell out of somebody, right? Is it the last of, you get old. You have a lifespan of about 70 years. So you got to get shit popping within those 70 years. Every day you go to sleep, that's one day less in your life. That's an X on a wall. To a period of time that's 5 billion years from now, or shit, even a billion years from now, or even a million years from now, where everything turned hard. The softness of the tissue is now some kind of nanotech that doesn't feel moisture, doesn't get cold, doesn't get hot, can withstand space, can probably walk in the goddamn sun. We don't know. Memories of the past people, just like we have memories of, hey, how did everything start with us? We don't know. So those people up there, we would just be fossils. We would be paintings on the wall to these people all the way up into those times. And I don't know about y'all, but I find that shit a I find it very fascinating that just like they discover cave art, right? Like they discover cave art right now, they're going to discover our city art. Or possibly cave art also, which will probably be graffiti and other, you know, items that we use now and we take for granted of or whatever. So now the other thing about this whole leaving Earth, in a way, it's amazing how the so-called two richest people in America, Elon Musk and Jeff Bezos, they want to reach out into space. You know, with somebody like that, they probably know something that we don't know. That's probably giving them that edge. Like, okay, instead of focusing on, like, you know, the Facebook guy, VR technology, they basically want to leave the planet. And I think Stephen Hawking said, for our species to survive and thrive, we have to leave this planet because it's basically all your eggs in one basket. If you get a comet to smash into Earth, a nice sized comet, it will wipe out all humanity. Just like that. Zip. Bow. Done. It's a wrap. We will cease to exist. So, I think the way to go about this now, just say if I was in charge, and I doubt that it happened, but just say if I was in charge of getting humans off this planet, even though I would be long dead, my kids would be long dead, their kids would be long dead, their kids' kids would be long dead, but we are working towards future civilizations on Earth or whatever to accomplish that. Because that would be a very hard feat to accomplish. Think about this. We went to the moon, right? No, I don't think so. And whoever want to come after me, I don't care. I don't think we went to the moon. Because first of all, why we didn't go back to the moon if we went to the moon? I think I've seen one scientist say, I don't know if he worked for NASA or whatever. Somebody asked him, why haven't we been back to the moon yet? And he said, we lost the technology. It wasn't no goddamn technology back then. It wasn't, you see what we got now? We got iPhones now. We got everything on this little screen. If you got an Android, I don't know. I'm just talking about iPhones right now. But all I'm saying is this. We have the technology to go to the moon, but no human. Think about this shit. Since one step for man, that BS, right? Now, one other country actually stepped foot on the moon. No other human stepped foot on the moon. Come on. So, the hardest part of the second part of this is the travel. So just say 100 years went past and you have all the money in the world, sort of like Elon Musk, right? Still today, it will probably cost more money than the whole Earth has to get a person, just probably one person. And it's impossible to get one person. You need a whole fleet. All right. So check this out. Like I said before, to get to Alpha Centauri or Proxima Centauri or the planet that is so-called orbiting Proxima Centauri, which is, I think it's Proxima B, right? It would take 4.2 light years. Like I said, it sounds close when you hear in other, you know, black holes or other solar systems or galaxies are a billion light years away. Like something a billion light years away, we would never get to. Like, and the thing about space, even seeing through my telescope, right, is we are able to see places that we would never go, that humans would never go. And that is messed up. That is the biggest tease that I think that any, you know, civilization or animal, I would say animal because I think we animals some way, somehow we animals. It's the biggest F you to the point that we can see a beautiful galaxy. And it's probably teeming with life. And we just would never get there. Ever. So that makes you think, like, when you think of evolution or just nature itself, or whoever built all of this. Was it, if it was a fluke or whatever, whoever built all of this, for us to see something that we can never go to, you have to factor on other theories that everything that you see in space is basically a hologram. It's not meant to be reached because you would never reach it. It's just light particles, sort of like clouds. Like when you're flying in an airplane and you look down at the clouds, if you was to jump out the airplane and try to grab on a cloud, you would go right through that mother. You go right through it, smack the ground. It's like you can't hold it in your hand. You can't really do another one. It's an illusion. Like water vapor or something like that, right? So if you look at the same kind of situation when you're looking into space or when you're watching one of those science, you know, channels or programs, and they just showing space and the beautiful galaxies and black holes and shit, we can never get there. When you see Andromeda, which is a beautiful galaxy right next to us, you can never, ever, ever get there. And that is messed up. All right, let me keep going. My bad, I got off on a tangent right there. So let's break this down. If you take our fastest probe, I think it was NASA and Germany together, right? It's called the Helios probe. The Helios probe goes about 250,000 kilometers per hour. Sounds fast, right? Sounds fast. No, it's not really fast. Because at that speed to get to Proxima Centauri, the place we want to go, as humans, the place we want to go, it would take 18,000 years to get there. Yes, 18,000 years. Now, if you're talking about a probe, which cannot fit nobody on, right? It's just got wings. I guess that's solar power, right? Or whatever. And it's just a device with instruments and probably bring some other stuff to pick up different light or whatever, right? It's research kind of shit. But if you use a ship that humans can actually get on and, you know, eat on, use the bathroom on, live on, it will probably take 80,000 years just to get to Proxima Centauri. So you know what this looking like? It's looking like the space tease that I was just talking about. You can be looking in your telescope, right? let's have some fun real quick. Let's have some fun. Just say you're looking in your telescope, right? And you just looking. You got some big ass telescopes, like the size of your backyard. Let's play that game, all right? Size of your backyard. You're looking at a telescope, and you just, you know, just combing the black sky, and you come across a planet, which is very fictional. You won't be able to see no damn planet with a telescope. Let's keep going with this. And you see that, oh shit, is that alien women? Oh my God. They got three breasts. Oh, is that food? Cities of gold? Oh my God, they having fun over there. You know what? You will never get there. In your life, in your kid's life, in your kids' life, you gotta understand how far is you traveling somewhere. I don't care if everybody on this planet was to get on some kind of space colony kind of shit, right? And somehow it took 20 years just to load everybody up there. Just say we had to get it. Just say our core was slowing down. And when your core slow down, you basically, your earth probably stops spinning. You have no protection from the sun. So you got to get out, right? And they estimated, hey, we got 100 years to get off this planet because we cannot jump start the core. You can't jump start this planet. So if scientists say we have 100 years to get off this planet and the only place to go is Mars or Proxima B, which is the planet. So we already know what Mars is. We already know what Mars looked like.